Welcome to the glass plate. In the lecture on heat and mass transfer, we discussed the cooling of a sphere that is surrounded by a colder gas or liquid. We assumed during that the temperature of the sphere internally is uniform. That is, the resistance to heat transfer is completely on the outside and there is no significant resistance to heat on the inside. As a consequence, we argued, at any point in time, the temperature throughout the sphere will be the same. But of course, the sphere is cooling, so during time, the temperature is dropping. We set up a heat balance, and I give here the result that we arrived at. The temperature of the sphere is changing with time due to, in essence, outflow, this outflow of the sphere, because there is a driving force. The sphere is hot, its surface is hot, the surrounding medium far away is cold. All this stuff is coming from heat transfer coefficient H, written in terms of a Nusselt number, area through which heat is transported out of the sphere, the outer area of the sphere itself, and this rho S, the density of the sphere, CPS, the specific heat of the sphere times its volume, and that times T would have been the internal energy. And I just took out all the constants and moved them to that side. How do you solve such an equation? Well, let's first look at what are the variables. T, the sphere, is obviously our unknown that we would like to have as a function of time. What is here unknown? T infinite, T far away, is a given constant. Nusselt is a given constant, 2 in the case, because we were dealing only with conduction away from a sphere. D is a constant, the diameter of the sphere is not changing during cool down. A and V are thus also constant, and rho S and Cp are by and large constants. Thus, what is written here, everything here, is a constant that we named alpha, just to keep notation short and better see what we need to do. So I'll rewrite this equation. The time derivative of the temperature equals minus alpha times the driving force, which contains the temperature difference. This is a linear first order differential equation that has a standard way of solving. For instance, what you could do is use what's called separation of variables. Anything with TS moves to the left side, everything else to the right side. So the dTs, as if this is a real ratio, is kept on the left side. And the dT is multiplied away to the other side. The alpha is sitting there, so this would be the right-hand side. The right-hand side originally contained TS minus Tinf, and I put that on this side. Now I have separation of variables. Note that I can't separate this out. For obvious reason, it's the driving difference that counts. But I can write that here behind the d, put brackets around it, because the d of ts minus tinf is the same as the d of ts, as d of tinf is the d of a constant, that's zero. So without any penalty, I can write it this way. And now, if I integrate both sides, I have standard functions that need to be integrated. And I can do that. This is, in essence, d function over function. The primitive is the natural logarithm. So here I get ts minus tinf natural logarithm. This side is easy. Alpha is a constant. Doesn't depend on t. So integrating a constant over t is just multiplying by t. And then obviously, because I integrate a boundary or an integration convex, constant slips in. How can I find it? Initial conditions. The sphere starts cooling at T equals zero. I start my clock at that point and it had then a temperature T as zero. If we put this in, then here T as zero appears, here a zero appears. So combining these two gives you the very quick and simple answer of what this constant is, as the logarithm of the starting temperature difference. I can put these together. We'll do that on this part. I continue again in blue so that you can see the different steps. Rather than writing C, I write the logarithm of this initial difference. Rather than writing it on the right-hand side, I move it to the left-hand side. And that gives me the logarithm of the unknown temperature corrected for that far away, minus my constant, and that equals what is left over here, minus alpha, the constant, times t. Now these two can be easily grouped together. Logarithm of A minus logarithm of B, because that's basically what it said, is the same as the logarithm of the ratio A over B. So this can be written as the logarithm of the ratio. That is nice, because now it's a dimensionless ratio, temperature over temperature. And that is needed because the logarithm can only be taken from dimensionless quantities. I don't know how to do the logarithm of a meter. Is that the same as the logarithm of 100 centimeters? I would guess so, but I don't know what it means. So it's better to cast it in this way. Now, rather than writing it implicit that you have to take the logarithm, you can also take the exponents, the exponential function on both sides. So if you take the exponential function of this, then exponent of the logarithm is a very complicated way of writing just the argument. And on this side you get thus the exponent of minus alpha t. This is the cooling down of the sphere purely by conduction. Just for fun, suppose I would have an egg boiled, and that egg I treat it as a sphere. I know an egg is not a sphere, but for the sake of the argument, it's about 5 centimeters. The lambda of air, because it's cooling in air, I can look up, is 0.024 watts per meter Kelvin. Starting temperature, so the T is 0, on the order of 100 degrees Celsius, I just boiled it. Temperature in the room, on the order of 25 degrees Celsius. With these parameters, I can estimate my alpha. It's just filling in if I know what egg is made of. Well, egg, like many foods, has densities pretty close to water. How do I know? It just floats if you put it in water, so it must have the density of water. And I can put here 1,000 kilo per cubic meter. Specific heat of egg. Tougher to estimate. Well, specific heats vary not that much. They roughly range from 1,000 to 4,000 and a bit for water. So a fair estimate of this one is, let's say that it's half that of water. Not unreasonable for food. So it's 2,000 per kilogram per Kelvin. The only unknown is now the Nusselt number. Actually, we derived everything for Nusselt is 2. If I fill that in, and I ask myself, when is the egg at 45 degrees? It's going to be pretty long. It's a few hours. The cooling down of an egg takes a few hours. I don't think so. If I make one for breakfast and I put it on my plate, I don't have to wait until afternoon until I can eat it. Where is the catch here? Well, that Nusselt is 2, says that it's only conduction, but it's not. A hot egg, air will rise up because it's hot here and will be replaced by cool air. So a natural circulation around the egg starts and the cooling is much faster. By and large, we could look into it and find numbers and you would get Nusselt is 20, something like that. Now the waiting time, if you fill in all the numbers, you can do that yourself, I'm pretty sure. Out of this, with Nusselt is number, the waiting time tall is on the order of half an hour. reasonable. It's not a minute, not a few minutes, I know. I don't have to wait until everything is 45 degrees. I can start peeling off the shell quicker. But I do know that I consume it within half an hour, otherwise my egg is cold. And I got another reason why this is probably a bit too long. Evaporation. This egg is wet. And even if I peel off, moisture comes out of it. Evaporation is a very powerful way of cooling down. It's not in my analysis. It's much more complicated. But I do know that that brings this time down. Try it yourself with an egg and see how long it takes before it has cooled down to temperatures like this. Or 40 if you want it. You can use a normal thermometer on the outside and try it, see what happens. Good luck with these exercises. See you at the next lecture.